Praise the Lord. Isn't that wonderful? We appreciate that. I think we're just going to turn them up a little bit more next time, though, right? I don't know about you, but I was humming back here. Probably made it worse for everybody, but that's all right. I like to hum and sing along. Don't like necessarily get up here and sing with everybody. I like to get in the background and hum a little bit. And we should be making a joyful noise unto the Lord, shouldn't we, today? It's a wonderful day that God has made, and the Bible says let's rejoice and be glad in it. Now, the way we can really get glad is we get our swords here this morning, right? I hope you brought your sword, because, you know, if you don't have your Bible and you don't follow along, you're not going to know if I'm telling you the truth or not. Isn't that right? And only those, by the way, who understand what truth is will what? Be able to defeat the enemy here in the last days, isn't it? You have to know what truth is because he's out to deceive. Our subject for today is I want that power. Several weeks ago we began this and we did part one, if you'll remember. Now, as my memory works a lot of times, I'm sure that we forget. So I'm going to go over some of the things that we covered, because this would be part two. I want that power. Now, the power we're talking about is Holy Spirit power. We've prayed for that already this morning, haven't we? That the power of the Holy Spirit would consume us. You have your Bible. I'd like for you to turn to Acts chapter 2. Acts chapter 2. We're going to read a couple of verses. And you'll find these very familiar to you. And also in the book of Joel, you'll find these same words. But we're going to do it Acts, if you'll do it with me. Acts chapter 2, verses 17 and 18. Acts chapter 2, verses 17 and 18. The Bible says, "And it shall come to pass in that last days, saith God, I will pour out what?
My spirit
upon all flesh." Acts chapter 2, verses 17 and 18. "And your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, and your young men shall see visions, and your old men shall dream dreams. And on my servants and upon my handmaidens I will pour out in those days of my spirit, and they shall what? And they shall prophesy." Friend, if we ever needed anything in the movement of the church today, is the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Many people take that a little bit to extremes, but I want you just to go as far as God wants us to go in Scripture. Does anyone here today feel like we need the baptism of the Holy Spirit?
Yes.
I do. I want to be baptized with power that the Holy Spirit can give. Do you remember the disciples? Disciples, after they received the baptism of the Holy Spirit, received the Holy Spirit inside of them, that then when they began to preach and teach, it was different than ever before. There was power that came out of every word that they said, when before people might hear it and they'd just turn and walk away. But now it was accompanied by real Holy Spirit power, that people were compelled to listen like never before. In fact, I read one time, it said in there that the disciples, when they were teaching and preaching, listen carefully, it was a second edition of Jesus himself. That's exactly how it should be for us today. It should no longer what? Be I, but Christ who lives in me. So it should not be man's teaching, but when someone hears you teaching or giving the word or testifying, they should what? Should be hearing Jesus. When Holy Spirit accompanies the work, Holy Spirit gives utterances. But why aren't we seeing more manifestations? See, I want that power. You see, too often, especially, and may I be bold enough to say, a lot of time in Adventist churches, we're very quiet, some of us. There's others who get a little loud once in a while. And it's all right. I feel like getting loud at times, and I'll probably get loud. You know, I've always been excited about things. Whatever I went to do, I always put some feeling and emotion into it. How about you? When you play softball or basketball in my days, I tell you, I gave it all, you know. Go till I couldn't go anymore. And in the cause of Christ, why not? It should be exciting to us. But why aren't we seeing more of this power? Well, we need to want that power, number one. We're going to look at four things. Won't do them all today. And that's what's good about when we tape them, that they're available if people are interested. Number one is, I want that power. Today you have to say, I want that power. Then we have to prepare for receiving that power. See, a lot of people say, I want that power, I want that power. and we're not willing to do anything to receive it. We're not ready. We're not willing to receive. We're not willing to make any changes. We just say, well, I want that power. I see it in somebody else that looks good. I want it. No, there's a preparation for it. And then how do we receive that power inside of us? What do we do with that power? Or what does that power do with us? And then as that power comes in, is how do we witness with this Holy Spirit power? Will it be different than we ever maybe have before? Witnessing with the power of God. Why is it in the church that God said the last days He's going to pour out His Spirit upon all flesh? Men and women, children will be doing things that they're not really accustomed to doing. But they've been preparing for it. They've been studying. They've been praying. They've been asking God to use them. And when the Spirit of God is poured out on an individual, you cannot keep silent. Things are happening. I read in a book called Four Testimonies, 6:13, made this little paragraph, a little statement I thought was very, very interesting. I'm a believer in looking and not saying, well, this church, this individual, these people are right, and whatever they do, they're right. We all have to be tested by the Scripture. Does that make sense? The Scripture is what tests us and proves whether we are of God or not. Remember, the devil has chosen to work inside the churches, not outside. Does that make sense? Does it make sense to say for every truth that God has, the enemy has a counterfeit? Does that make sense? So if there is a truth of what happens when you die, the devil has an heir. If there is a truth about the second coming of Jesus, the devil hates that thought. He doesn't like people. For instance, when we say, well, we are Seventh-day Adventist Christians. Seventh-day Adventist means we go on the seventh day, right? Advent means we believe in the second coming of Jesus. All the churches should at least be in harmony with at least one aspect of the 2 points. We all should be proclaiming what? The imminent soon return of Jesus Christ. If we are not doing that, we are none of His. We cannot possibly be, because His children is going to know when He's at the door. Isn't that right? When the time of His coming. And the other, when you say Advent, well, we're talking about Advent, that second coming, that power, that eternal blessed hope that we have. The excitement that we will not just be in this world and then that's all there is to it. You realize if I only had the hope in this world, I'd be most miserable. Somebody with me? I mean, it'd bring a little joy and comfort in this life here. But if there was no future life, no heaven, I wouldn't be happy. I'm looking forward to that future life with Jesus. Why isn't there more power in the movement? Why is it that we're afraid sometimes to pray for the sick? Why is it sometimes we're afraid to pray, as it were, that maybe the Bible says to cast out demons? Why is it that we're not seeing it? This little paragraph said something like this. The reason why our people have not more power in that they profess the truth, but they do not practice it. The reason we don't have more power in the church is because what? We profess to know what is truth, but we are not practicing it. Now, if we want power in the church, now remember, the title today is what? I want that power. I want that power. So if I want that power, then one way is I have to realize that I have to not only just know what truth is, but I have to practice it. I have to let it go into my heart, into my life, day in and day out. It must be a part of me, natural. And so we have to see that we have to learn to practice that truth. You say, yeah, how can I really receive it? How did the disciples receive the power? You remember on the day of Pentecost in Acts chapter 2? What did they do? Good, they prayed. They were seeking for that Spirit. And they were willing, by the way, to go, as it were, and lock themselves into the upper room. And they were willing to stay there until they received it. Wow. Yeah. You realize how difficult it is to get people to come out for 2 hours of church service. You can see it today. Why? Well, many because of the holidays. They've got family. Now, I'm not bashful about talking about it. Because we find it. The real sincere, the honest people will get serious about it. You know, God doesn't take holidays. Are you still with me? You know, He still showed up today, praise God. He didn't sit around the table. Some people sat around the table since about Wednesday. They haven't got up from it yet. And they just keep going on and on and on, you see. God expects us to put Him first. It's okay to have these things and do these things, but we need not. You know what people will say? Well, I would have been there, and I'll find out some, I guarantee you. But they'll say, well, I was there, but you know, we had some family and friends came in, and so we decided. Exactly. If they are believers, they should be here anyway. If they're not believers, I need to set them a good example. What do you say? We love you. We're glad that you're here. Come with us if you'd like to. But if not, stay here. Make yourself at home. We're going to be gone for a couple hours and we'll be right back. That is setting a real example. We love you. We're not trying to, right? Make yourself at home. We'd want you to come. But if you don't, stay here. It's all right. We're going to go to church. That will make an impression on people. Do you know that? And some of you have done that. Praise God. We need to do that. To set and say a holiday or something, you know, is dominant in our church attendance is dead wrong. How would Jesus look at it? How does heaven look at it? That's how we have to view these things today. We need to seek for the power of the Holy Spirit. A little book I read, it's called Testimonies to Ministers, was very good. There's a paragraph there. It says, seek the Lord most earnestly. Now notice this. If I want that power, I'm going to have to what? Seek Him. I think some of you mentioned that they were seeking and what? In the upper room. Yes. And they were praying. And they were willing to spend as much time as was needed until the power came. Were they any more sure that they had received that power than you and I can be sure that we can receive that power today? Were they any more sure at that time? Did they have this? Did Jesus tell them, now you go up in that room and you stay for 10 days, I guarantee you, you'll receive that power. No. They did not know that at all, did they? They were by faith believing that they, what? Submitted themselves to God. If they truly got serious. See what God's looking for today, and He's looking for me, He's looking for you to get serious. To get real serious with Him. That He might be a priority. But they knew the Holy Spirit would come, but there was things that had to be done first. Do you remember the disciples? Could we classify some of the disciples as selfish at one time? Yes! We had mamas butting in, didn't we? Now you're going to remember my sons now, aren't you? Where are they going to sit when you come in your kingdom? You know? Who's going to be honored? Who's going to be closest to Jesus when He's in the kingdom? What position am I going to have? Jesus said this foolishness had to go. This always wanting a position that you don't have or I don't have or coveting somebody else's talent. Jealousy's in the church. Oh, I've been there longer. I should be doing all the... Friend, that all has to go. Nothing can hold back what God has anointed and what God wants to take place. Man may want to try and may try to hold you back, but man cannot hold you back when God has designated you to do something for His cause. We need not worry about it. We just need to take the opportunity that God gives us and you know what? Pray about it, and when that opportunity comes, God will make sure that it happens. God will make sure that it happens. So we need to do what the disciples did. We can do it today. As it were, go into the upper room. Now notice what first thing, we have to put away our sins. Interesting. Put away our sins? And in this paragraph of the ministers, it said, tarry there in Jerusalem and be endowed with power from on high. Purify, listen to this, purify your souls by obeying the truth. Do what? Purifying your souls by obeying the truth. So you have to know what truth is, right? Let it live out in your life, and the truth will purify the soul and make it heaven born. Oh, it's wonderful. And people will say, okay, well, I'm going to ask God to forgive me, and I'm going to wait here till the power comes. Friend, you realize the Spirit, the Holy Spirit of God does not work beyond human power of resistance. Did we get that? The Holy Spirit does not work beyond human power of resistance. In other words, the Holy Spirit is much more powerful than any of us. Isn't that right? We don't stand. But the Holy Spirit does not force Himself upon you to make changes in your life. He brings them lovingly and kindly to you, makes you aware of those things. But how difficult in our Christian experience sometimes has to do with the resistance that I give the Holy Spirit. Does that make sense? Some of you are riding a bicycle or something, and you have these levers or something on it, it's called resistance. Mm-hmm. It's a little, you pedal them pretty free. Then you start pushing 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Oh, man, the resistance. And you get a little bit tired. What do? Back it down a little bit. You don't want all that resistance. You're actually fighting that which will enable you to be better physically fit. You see, the resistance is there for a purpose. The more that we can deal with that resistance, the stronger that we get. But if we resist the Holy Spirit and we put and keep resisting and resisting, pretty soon we have this thing called the unpardonable sin too, by the way, don't we? You cannot resist what you understand is truth. Once you understand something is a truth, regardless of how minute we might think it to be, it becomes sin. Think about it. Once we know something to be truth, and yet we don't want to make the changes, we don't want to do anything, it becomes sin to us. The Bible says, to him that knoweth to do good and doeth it not, to him it is sin. Didn't say about anybody else. To him it is. So once we understand what truth is, then does it make sense to say today we're accountable? Absolutely it does. See, a man can refuse the voice of God if he wants to. He can refuse the Holy Spirit. A man can choose to regulate himself. Now, I'm going around here so we see a little bit here. You say, I want that power. There has to be things we're willing to do in order to receive that power. If you do not receive that power, dear friends, we will not go through the time of trouble that's just before us. We will not make it to the end. We cannot live the victorious life without the full power of the Holy Spirit. And you know what? Many times in our Christian experience, we want a part-time religion. We want a part-time religion. Think about it. We see it in our own church. We see it in other churches. We find people are part-time Christians. They'd never call themselves that, and they get angry at me because I call them part-time. Because they might choose a certain service they like to come to, and they let the other go. Who of us is big enough to say we don't need what God has to offer and all of it in one day? None of us. When we say, I don't need the Sabbath school, I don't need the lesson study, all that, do we know everything? You realize in the Sabbath school, the lesson study part is very, 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 maybe more important than even the worship hour. We learn a lot of things in that time. How to live the Christian life, how to gain victories. We learn how to be the kind of person God wants us to be. It's a very, very important time. Gearing us up, but yet many times it's not important to us because we'd have to get up a little bit earlier. We'd have to sacrifice a little time doing something else. Friend, my point is God is looking for people who love heaven, love being in His presence. It brings them joy and excitement to be in the presence of God, not to be hurried away. There are people living today, I'm going to use this word here if you allow me to do it. They like to regulate themselves. Is somebody with me? What is a regulator? There's a lot of different types of regulator. What if you're a welder? Is there a regulator on those tanks? Yes. What does a regulator do? Something may happen, isn't that right? If you don't have those regulators adjusted, even here, just allow me to do this, a thermostat, for maybe those who are thinking a little bit in a different direction, thermostat regulates what? The heat or the air conditioning. It's a regulator in that. Some of us, we don't want to do the way God wants to do it. We want to regulate ourselves. We want to get it just about where it's comfy for me because I don't have to make a really big change. We're not worried about anybody else. We're just going to get, I'm hot in here. We're going to turn. What about everybody else? We become even selfish with that. But if we become a self-regulator in the cause of Christ, we are not a fit vessel of honor for God. Did you know that? We are not a fit vessel of honor. If we tried to regulate ourselves, see, I'm too selfish. I don't know about you. To regulate myself, you see, I'm just going to, what is convenient, what is easiest, what is less difficulty for me, less problems. But God gives in His Word the way He wants to regulate me because He knows me better than I know myself. How many of us really know ourselves well enough to regulate what we need to prepare us for heaven? Is there anybody here today? There is. I'm going to talk to you afterwards. None of us will say we know. We don't know ourselves because the heart is what? Desperately wicked. And who can know it? Yeah. And so God knows how to regulate us and what we need to prepare us for heaven. Let's let Him do it. so that we can be a fit vessel. And some of us may even refuse to correct defects of character when God has pointed those things out to us. Think about it. Has God ever pointed anything out to you? Has God ever pointed anything out to you that you've had to struggle with? I'm still struggling with some things. How about you? He's made it plain that these things are not pleasing, what? In His sight. And so we don't want this. We're saying, oh man, I tell you, He's pointed them out to me, and I'm sure that this is not pleasing, and I'm sure this will not make it with me to heaven. But you know what? We say, you know what? It's just too much trouble to break up my old habits and my old ways. We love them. See, the test is coming for all of us here. We love our old habits. We say we don't. We know they're not any good. We know that God has impressed us that they're dead wrong, that these things will not inherit the kingdom of God. But yet we don't want to let them go because we, down deep, we like that. We like it. We don't want to give it up. I know watching such and such a program is not very good, but I like it. I know I shouldn't listen to this type of music, but I like it. I shouldn't be watching this, but I like it. I shouldn't be looking at these things, but I like it. It always boils down to selfish doing what? The thing that got the devil to begin with is, I like it. Isn't that what he said? I don't like your ways, God, but I like my ways. God said, but they're not good. Well, they may not be, but I like it. And so we find people saying they want heaven to be their home, and they say, I know God has pointed out these character flaws, but I don't want to break up my old ways, my old habits, the things that I'm doing. I'm happy where I'm at. Be careful to say you're happy where you're at. Friend, until you occupy the eternal glories of heaven, don't get happy where you're at. Don't get content where you're at. Don't feel everything's all right where you're at. Until we have that crown placed on our heads by the precious hand of Jesus, it's not all right. Are you still with me? We still may have some battles to fight that maybe we're not aware of. Why do some of us sometimes have such a difficult time even talking about Jesus? Well, okay, yeah, sure. Yes. Oh, sure, that's a good answer. Sometimes we just can't talk about Him, or we can't seem to pray. Thought how interesting that is. I think probably today, one of the answers, that was a good one, one of the answers might be too is, how can we communicate something that we've never received? How can you talk about Jesus if you've never really, really received Him? How can you talk about a converted life if you've never really been converted? How can you talk about gaining victory in your life when you really haven't gained very many victories? When you've gained victories, you can talk about victories. When you've seen the power of God work in your life, you can talk about it. When you spent time with Him in the closet, you can pray and outside. Did you know that? Out loud. You can pray. Communicate. You can't communicate what you haven't received. If you've received it, you can communicate it. Mm-hmm. It's easy. I told my wife that day, they told me for the special that we were going to do, and I the Lord gave me a good chastising. I don't mind to tell you. He let me have it. And it's okay. I said, thank you, when He got done. Because it was so quick, they said, you know, and a little email came in and said, well, can He give a 5 or 10 minute talk about Jesus, birth of Jesus? But then there's going to have somebody read the whole story of Jesus and boom, but you know, for the kids and all, it's nice. Just without really thinking, I was there, I said, oh, honey, five, you know, it takes me a while to get warmed up. Anybody with you? Huh? Yeah. Well, what am I going to say in 5, 10 minutes? It wasn't complaining because that wasn't enough time. It's like, oh, all these thoughts and then the other. I said, I don't know what I'm going to do. Now, can you imagine a preacher saying, I don't know what I'm going to do? What am I going to do? 5, 10 minutes on the boy. Went to bed that night about 3 a.m., woke right up out of the bed. Lord said, what kind of problem are you having? You know, in your mind, not audible. And I knew exactly what He was talking about. I said, right back, I just in my mind, you know, 5, 10 minutes to talk about this whole thing, and they're going to read the story. It's like going over the same ground. One more, you know, just. And it was real simple. He said, Kenny, don't you know me well enough that you could talk about me or should be able to talk about me for hours? Wow. I said, Lord, I'm sorry. I never thought of it that way. I should know you well enough. If it's 5 minutes, it's okay. If it's 10 minutes, it's okay. If it's 15 or 20. Isn't he big enough and great enough? Of all the stuff that he does and everything he's done, he's creator, he's redeemer, he's our sustainer, and we live and move and have our being through him, that we could just talk about his goodness. And I said, I never quite thought about it like that. He said, should I remind you of some things that you need to be reminded of? And I thought, he's taking me to the closet. He's going to give me a good whipping. And you know why? I said, go ahead and take me. How sad that I had to say, well, what am I going to do? And he started with the great, vast universe. He said, Kenny, when's the last time you looked up? I said, well, Lord, I'm always looking up. When have you looked up? See, sometimes we look up, but are we looking up? You see every one of those things up there? You may call them things. I know them by name. Every one of them. And I hung it there, and I said, stay, and it stayed. Now I'm wondering what I'm going to talk about. Oh. He said, things that you cannot even imagine. Your little finite mind, your little humanness, weakness. And he reminded me about Job, you know. He said, like Job, he said, I had to remind Job, where were you? You see. Yeah, when I made, where were you? When that plumb line was out, where were you? Said, do you remember the one that walked on those dusty trails in Bethlehem and Jerusalem? Do you know the one that went to the cross for you because you needed a Savior? Because you sinned, you fell short. The one who's created a new heaven, a new earth. The one who said, I'm willing to die for you. I'm willing to go through all that men can put on me, all that the devils of hell can put against me. I'm willing to do it by God's grace, by His strength. I empty myself of self and be filled with the Father and whatever they have because you're worth it. Do you know enough about me to speak for 5 or 10 minutes? Yes, Lord, I'm learning. He said, I'm going to tell you some more things. Well, I won't go into everything, but 3 hours. I got to know Him a little bit better. He reminded me of things that we should know, or maybe we knew. But sometimes maybe we have to be reminded of who He is and who we are. For Him to say that, I'm God, and yet I'm willing to give my life for you. And I want to do more. I want to give you that kind of power that I have. While I walk this earth, so that you too may gain the victory over the enemy. In the book of Mark, if you'll turn quickly, Mark chapter 14, New Testament, Mark chapter 14. When we need a wake-up call from God, dear friends, He'll give it to you if you want it. And remember, if you don't want it, you're not going to get it. So the first thing we say, well, are we wanting to receive this power from heaven? First of all, we have to say what? I want that power. And then we proceed down how to receive that power. Mark chapter 14, verse 38. What does the Bible say? You quoted basically this in principle today. It says, watch ye and do what?
Pray.
And pray, lest you enter into what? Here is it. The Spirit truly is ready, but the flesh is what? Huh? Okay, now notice that I underlined this in my Bible. Maybe you should too. Not only said that we're to watch and we're to pray, but notice this here, because he said the Spirit truly is ready. See, we keep thinking what? Latter rain experience. Is somebody home? We think of the early rain. Now look at me. Listen, if you haven't studied about the latter rain, it's a subject that we need to be going over. It's very, very important. that we receive the latter rain that will equip us to go through the time of trouble. Now notice here it says, I like this, it said the Spirit is what? Truly is ready. Now, Review and Herald article in the March 19, written, this is written in 1895, by the way. See if it doesn't gel with what I'm talking about. Anytime I read something from another book, if it doesn't gel with the Bible, throw it out. And by the way, if I do that very often, throw me out. Somebody's not with me. No matter what we read from any other kind of book, it must harmonize with Scripture. Scripture is paramount. It is our foundation. And long as it harmonizes, I've often said, I don't care where truth comes from. If it's truth, I want it. It says, the descent of the Holy Spirit upon the church is looked forward as a time in the future. You remember, latter rain? It's going to fall out one of these days. And boy, I tell you, people's going to be equipped. And man, we're going to get on fire. We're going to finish this work. Man, we're going to go home. Have you often, I've heard that all my life. It's going to fall one of these days. But people forgot to remind me, even the pastor of years, but Kenny, you have to be ready to receive it. There's preparation that has to take place in your life. They act like it's just going to fall and everybody in the church is going to soak it up and everybody's going to just, there'll be a few maybe sitting beside you, a little bit dull, a little bit sleepy. They're not going to receive it. But what, everybody going to receive? No! When God said that holy, that latter rain is going to fall upon the people, He's talking about those ones He's getting ready to take to heaven. And the latter rain cannot fall on people with sin, unconfessed sin in their life. Did you know that? That way He'd be covering sin. He doesn't do that. So if we've got unconfessed sin in our lives, should we not be praying? God, forgive me. And then you'll have these other, well, I would do that, but there's things I've forgotten. Listen, let's quit making excuses. Don't fool around with God. Are you following me? God knows all these things. It's so easy. God wants it to be easy. He wants you to say, and me to say, God, for the things that I've even forgotten, the things that I've wounded and hurt other people I can't even think of right now, if you want me to make it right, impress me to know what to do. Until then, God, let that blood cover it. I'm sorry. I don't want any sin in my life. I don't want any stain in my life. I want that Holy Spirit. After all, God has arranged it so. He wants it so. He's not trying to withhold it from you, but He can't give it to you and me until our life is ready. So when we have known sin in our life, it has to go. What did disciples do? They went to the upper room, and what did they do? They prayed and they confessed their sin. They laid everything out and said, oh God, forgive us. And I think some of them got down and some of them went to their brother. And they put their arm around their brother and said, oh, I was envying you for a long time. I thought you were closer to Jesus. I was backbiting and I was gossiping and I was saying things I shouldn't have said. It wasn't this hiding, it was letting it out. And as the Holy Spirit comes in, we can't look at each other with envy and jealousy if the Holy Spirit is inside. We just look at each other in love and respect. So it's no different what I'm talking about here than what they did on the day of Pentecost when the Holy Spirit came down. But said we look for it even as a group, as a church, something big that's going to wake us up. Since when do we need something bigger than what's happening in society right now? With the economy. With everything busting loose, we have no idea. The rulers don't know what to do. We understand that. No one said they say, out of the woods yet. Maybe God will allow it. Maybe He will not. Maybe this is it. But dear friends, we're looking for something future that will help us. But it is the privilege, I'm reading on, but it is the privilege of the church to have it now. Do you want it now? We're looking for what? Something to happen in the future? Holy Spirit power? She said, don't wait. You can have it what? You can have it now. We just read there in verse 38, Jesus said, the Spirit truly is ready. He said right here, you can have it now. Did you get it? He was talking about Jesus in Gethsemane. He was talking about those sleepy disciples. He was talking about those who didn't seem at that point to care enough about Him to lose a couple of winks of sleep. Somebody with me? They said they loved Him. Friend, could we be guilty of that today? Oh, Lord, we love You. Oh, yeah, we want to go to heaven. Well, can He just wait here and pray? The church, many times we're asleep. We say that we're not. But if we're not asleep, then shouldn't more things be happening? I'm talking about when the real Holy Spirit is poured out. There's not going to be this bickering, backbiting, gossiping going on in the church. It will not happen. Where the Spirit of God is present, dear friends, that will not take place. There will not be covetous and boastfulness and, oh, I did this and we did that and he's good at this, he's good at that. It will all be about Jesus. When the Spirit of God is inside the church, it will be seen in your life and in my life. I'm asking God to help me so I can see the wiles of the enemy and see, because spiritual things are spiritually discerned. I need that Spirit. I want that Spirit. It says we can have it now, and we do just what Scripture said. In this writing here, in March 1895, it said we must seek it, we must pray for it, and we must believe for it. And notice this, I like it. She says on here, we must have it. See, it's you think it's an option?
No, we can't make it without it.
We must have it. We must have it. And you know what? And it goes on to say, and heaven is waiting to bestow it upon us. Wouldn't that be sad? All of heaven is astir. They're waiting to bestow a special gift upon us, more so than what maybe you have and what I have. I pray that each one here, you have the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is speaking to you. But we're talking about in greater abundance, more power than we've ever experienced before in our life. Is it possible that we may do the works of Jesus Christ? Is it? What did he say? Greater things than I've done will you do. Wow. When will the body of Christ wake up? When will we prioritize our life, our homes, our commitment to Jesus Christ? When will Jesus be more important than Thanksgiving? When will Jesus be more important than Christmas? When will he be more important than our birthday? Somebody needs to get with me now. When will we really get down and say, he's going to be first? I want that power. In Acts chapter 5, turn with me there quickly. Acts chapter 5. Notice what the Bible says. You say, oh, I want that power. We can have it now if we're praying for it. We're believing. The Bible says he's ready to pour that Spirit out upon it. The Spirit is ready. You say, well, what's happening? Acts chapter 5, verse 32. Notice what the Bible says. Are we there? I don't hear much shuffling of paper here now. Like this. Acts chapter what? 5 verse what? 32. The Bible says, read it with me. And we are his witnesses of these things. And so all is also the what? Holy Ghost, whom God hath given to them that... What's the condition? What is the condition here? I want that Spirit, you're saying. I want that power. Well, if you want that power, the Bible says here, the Holy Ghost, God will give the Holy Ghost to them that what? Obey him, not disobey him. Think about it. The Holy Spirit will not be given to those who disobey. Now, God will work with us as, I like to think it, in my times of ignorance, God winks at. Is somebody with me? When I don't know, God says, it's okay, bless his little heart, he just doesn't know. And you know what? All every one of us that get into the kingdom by God's grace, we're going to look around and we're going to say, all that we thought we knew, sad, we didn't know anything. God is so merciful to have me up here. You ever think about, we always thought, well, this is what we know. How much? You ever think about, try to go and say all the things that you don't know about. Just about everything somebody mentions, I don't really don't know about it. Think of the millions and billions of things you don't know anything about, let alone the things that's way over our head, right? It's awesome. But there's condition of receiving the Holy Spirit. But there are people who say, I can be disobedient to God, disobedient to His law, His Ten Commandment law, and I do have the Holy Spirit. The Bible says no. We can bicker about it. You can discuss it. You can justify it all you want. My Bible says God hath given to them the Holy Ghost that obey Him. That's pretty clear, isn't it? But we have to realize there's what? How many spirits in the world? But main two, right? Two, right? Good and evil. Isn't that right? Yeah, the spirit of the enemy and the spirit of God that's working, and there's a great battle, and the battle is going on for your salvation and mine. Do you realize how important you are to heaven today? All of heaven is fighting for you and me. Think about it. All of heaven. There is a continual warfare going on. so that we can make it to heaven. Every day that we get up, we've got this, do this, and the other voice is saying, don't do that. I need to go do this. Well, you better not do this because that's not quite right there. We don't want to go that direction. There's a battle that's going on and waging for your mind. Yes. Friend, I'm telling you, when you say obey Him, you know what that word obey in the Greek means? That means those who submit to Him. Mm-hmm. Are you still there? Those who submit to God. Another word in the Greek says, for those who will conform their life. So in order to receive the Holy Spirit in the power, we have to be willing to conform our life into the image of Jesus Christ. If we're not conforming, then are we expecting to receive the power and the Holy Spirit power? No, you can't. The Bible says you can't have bitter and sweet water. He who is not with me is against me. So we have to realize there's decisions we have to make. There's times, yes, where we drift over this way and we're on the side of the enemy and we have to say, Lord, please forgive me. I want to get back on. There's not any time that I, at least in my mind, my thinking, that you're part of Christ and you're part of the devil. Somebody with me. There's never any time that you're part of Christ and part of the devil. You're one or the other. Every moment of your life, every moment of my life, we're on one side or the other. Think about it. There's never any time that we're... Because one goes and the other stays, or vice versa, right? One comes in, the other has to go. Every time Jesus come around, what happened to the enemy? He had to flee. Isn't that every time He had to go? And when you choose that you want the enemy, God says, okay, that's what you want. I'm going to leave. You see. The choice every day of our life, every decision that we make. To those obey in the Greek, the Holy Spirit is given a promise to them that, listen, that put Him first. These are words in the Greek when it says obey. Those who obey who put Him first. Those who are willing to conform their lives. Those who are willing to submit to Jesus Christ. Friends, it would be the greatest thing you've ever done in your life to submit to Him. To learn what is truth. You realize there's no peace in the world to those who don't know Jesus. There's no peace. You find people who their life is one torment, it seems. They never find rest. Have you ever met someone like that? They're in a problem every day of their life, and everybody that they reach out to, they don't like themselves, and they don't like other people. It's because they do not have Jesus in their life. You'll find that if you're unhappy, you don't like other people, your life is a torment, one thing after the other. Friend, we need to get down on our knees and ask God for a change. Those are telltale signs. Telltale signs. I don't know how much time we have left here, but I want you to turn the passage until somebody tells me, 1 Corinthians. I'm just now really starting to feel good. Look out. Woo! Somebody ask for the Spirit, okay? Pray for the Holy Spirit. Amen. It's an exciting time, don't you believe, in which we live. Holy Spirit, then we're gathering, is coming what? In great measure, the Bible says it's going to become in great measure. We read this one time. Let's read it again. 1 Corinthians 15, and we'll read verses 1 and 2. You have your pen. You may want to underline some of these things. These are words that we're going to look and do word studies on. It's very, very important because I believe that, listen, your salvation, my salvation, and victory depends on how we grasp these things. This is very, very important, dear friend. The Bible says, verse 1 of 1 Corinthians 15, it says, moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the what? 10, okay. The what? Gospel. Underline it. Which I preached unto you, which also ye have received, right? Underline it. And wherein ye stand, underline. By which also ye are saved, underline. If you keep in memory, right? Underline, right? Keep it in your mind. What I have preached unto you, unless ye have believed in vain. See, I find in the Bible that there is a belief that is in vain. Yes. Did you get that here? See, that confuses people's mind. They say, well, what do you mean I believed in vain? There is a belief that is in vain. In Matthew 15, what is it talking about? Jesus said, in vain do they worship me, teaching what? Doctrines, the commandments of men. Their belief, their Christianity, their walk with God is in vain, and He will say to them, depart from me, you workers of iniquity, I don't know you. Why? because they've disobeyed. If you love me, keep my commandments. It's very simple. Keep my commandments. Does that mean, oh, that's salvation if I do? No. Ten Commandments simply does what? It points out what sin is. 1 John 3. Sin is the transgression of God's law. There wouldn't be a pastor, I don't think, of any church that had the audacity to stand in the pulpit and say, and never ever preach upon this issue called sin. But when you ask for a definition of what sin is, they get hush-hush. Doesn't every minister, everywhere you turn on, and somebody saying we need to get rid of sin, need to gain victory over sin, this is sin. What is sin? Sin is the transgression of God's law. It's that simple. It doesn't save you, but it points out what sin is and drives me, what? To Jesus Christ, who can forgive me. By grace are you saved through faith. It is a gift, is what the Bible teaches. We need to learn more of what the gospel is. We can do a lot in Adventism. By the way, God has given great wisdom in Scripture. It's not for just Adventist people. It's for anybody that's willing to pick up this book. Do you know that? Who is God's people today? Well, some people say, well, you know, they're Adventists, or they're, you know, Church of God. Listen, God, you're not going to heaven because you go to Seventh-day Adventist church. Somebody with me? You're never going to get there because, well, I got my membership there. Listen, where's your name written? The Bible said it better be in the Lamb's Book of Life. Isn't that right? Have it wherever you want. And you know what? People know that, but they still will. They've just been so brainwashed, so confused to say, well, I know, but it needs to be. No, the Bible does not say it. Man might tell you, but the Bible says make sure your name's written in the Lamb's Book of Life. This is what it's all about, dear friends. God calls His people and His identifying marks as those who do what? Keep the commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus Christ. What is the testimony of Jesus Christ? The Bible said, Revelation 19, it is what, 10? It is the what, spirit of prophecy. God said it would have what? Spirit of prophecy in the last day church. He's had it in His church from the beginning of time. He said, I sent my prophets unto the people. And what did they do? They stoned them and they killed them. They never listened to them because they're always bringing a message of what? Let's get rid of sin. Get ready to meet Jesus. They were doing something. You remember every time God sent a prophet to a king, it's thought they were doing something what? Wrong. And He sent it to correct them. And one of the gifts, 1 Corinthians, what? Last days, prophets. Be in the church. And He says what? Until He comes again. So it shouldn't be shocking to anything or anybody. That's why Jesus said in here, and Paul talked about, He said, you're going to have to try the spirits. That's why I tell you, if I read from anything else other than this right here, I make sure what I read right here, it says it, or I won't read it. It's that simple. The Bible. Give me the Bible. The other helps to make it a little bit clearer so that my poor little mind can understand these deep things of God. Sometimes they're just like, wow. I just talk about the gospel, I get overwhelmed at some time. I don't know about you. There's so much in the gospel. The Bible says we need to. It includes grace, doesn't the gospel? It includes salvation. It includes that Jesus died for my sins. He was buried and He rose again. This is part of it. He said here that Paul was talking to his brethren. He said, I declare unto you the gospel. Do you realize how often that Paul's sermon were somewhat the same over and over and over? Not I, but Christ. You notice how many times he talked about the resurrection of Jesus Christ and the power that we can receive? He over and over and over, he presented Jesus Christ. Here was a man eloquent in speech and education, but he spoke as a child, he didn't understand what he was saying. And because he talked about Jesus, he lifted up the name of Jesus. And I think sometimes we like to get in, I love Daniel, I love Revelation, I love the prophecies of the last days. The person, right, who is believing that Jesus is coming will be studying the prophecies of the last days. They will understand what the mark of the beast is. They'll understand the image to the beast. They'll understand who that little horn power is. They'll understand these things because they have to know who it is. Jesus said that mark of the beast will be urged upon the world. And what? If any man worship the beast or his image, we understand all these things, right? They're going to be lost. The majority of the world has no idea who the beast is or the image to the beast. They have no idea. And you know what? Majority don't care. Some of our people don't care. Who've been around it maybe all their life. But friend, I'm talking south. It's not a matter of a quiz and how smart somebody is. It's a matter of equipping ourselves so that we can fight the enemy. How did Jesus fight the enemy, by the way? Amen. That's right. By the word of God. When he quoted, right? And you know what the devil did? What did the devil do? The devil had the audacity to come to Jesus and start quoting scripture. And he didn't quote it just right, did he? He is a liar. He can't even quote the scripture even though he knows it verbatim. He knows it. Listen, I'm not elevating the devil today. He knows it better than you know it. He could quote a lot more than any of it. All of us put together right here. He knows it so well that he can quote it and leave out exactly the words that he wants to make it say something else. You know that? He tried that on our Lord and Savior, but because Jesus knew the word. He was taught it at home. Mama put him on the knee. Mama taught him. Did you get it? They taught. He was a baby. He was taught. That he knew it so well that when he was quoted, it could have been an angel in his delirium, like, oh, no angels come to save me. I'm in this mess. As soon as the devil opened his mouth as an angel of light, he said, uh-oh, you're not who you said you were. Do you get it? That's the only way that we will not be deceived in the last days. We have to know. We have to know. We have to try the spirits. Isn't that right? It makes sense. And if we're not studying on our own, man said, wasn't this week in here, he said something about the importance of, it's not just coming and doing a Sabbath school lesson, as it were, and I'll just kind of paraphrase a little bit, or coming and listen to some other pastor tell you what's right and what's wrong, blah, 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 blah. We need to be studying for ourselves. We need to really be in that closet. We need to be praying. We need to be turning these pages and saying, God, what is it? Our eternal life depends upon it. And not just knowing what it is, but acting on it. Not acting on part of it. Remember, the power of God is being withheld, the Holy Spirit power, is because what? We say we know what truth is, but we are not practicing it. Isn't that right? That's what I said. We're not practicing it. Or we like to say, we're not living, well, preaching. We're not living what we preach. And remember, dear friends, it's not so much what the pastor says up here in the pulpit, it's what the church lives that the people will believe. So I can get up here and go and go and go on and on and on. But if the people here, myself, if we won't live it, if we won't let the right Christ live in us, it's useless. I want a church that's on fire. I don't care if it be few or if it be 100. It doesn't matter to me. But I want what's here. I want them on fire. I want them to love Jesus with all their heart. I want to love Jesus with all my heart. See, I'm open to that because I realize it's a necessity or heaven's not going to be my home. He has to be first in everything that we go to do. There's nothing should take the place of that. There's no time we should ever just put him off and say, well, I'm not going to go to church, I'm not going to study, I'm not going to pray because I need to go do this before. No. We're learning to make commitments. We're learning to make commitments. We're learning to pray. Sister Donna mentioned here a few weeks ago, remember? Pray that what? Don't say nothing. Let the rest of them. Somebody help me. Sister Donna stood up, had a testimony, said, I'm praying this every day of my life. And I said, you know what? I want that. Not that we don't do it, but I want that just like that. See, we're not soaking things in. And I said, you know, why don't we take that and pin that on our icebox too? Let me just tell you again, right? Then next week I'm going to ask you, quiz you again. I'm going to quiz you until you get it. You know why? Because I want to spend eternity with you. Isn't that right? Because I love you. You love your children, isn't that right? You love one another. You keep coming back and you keep coming back and say, hey, she said this. She said the Lord's been impressing her and she's been praying every day. She said what? Lord, help me to love you more each day. That's such a simple prayer, but how powerful. Lord, teach me how to love you more every day. That's awesome. And then we come to the point that we keep talking about here is that we don't have the physical food in our home until we've had the spiritual first. We just can't do it. And if one of us might forget or something, or run down and just take a drink, say, whoa, the other one's there to help to remind. And if we can't remember it, we post it on the icebox. See, it's a learning process. Who are we to take the physical before the spiritual? What's the most important thing to us? See, is the church the most important thing to you? Is God the most important thing to you? In what? It will show in our lives and our choices that we make. Well, I think that's simple. It will show. We'll say, yes, Lord, I know. The gospel. Gospel. We have to receive it. We're going to stand in it. We can be saved by it if we keep it where? in our minds here, 1 Corinthians 15, 1 and 2 is talking about receiving it. Let's read one more before we close today, because we'll hit on this harder next week. And it's found in Proverbs 2, 1 through 5. That way you'll get a chance to look at it, maybe have some thoughts of your own. The Old Testament, the book of Proverbs. Are we there? Proverbs chapter 2, Psalms, Proverbs chapter 2. Notice this, verses 1 through 5. Now remember, we had to do what? Paul said he preached what? The gospel? That's what? The salvation, isn't that right? He preached Jesus Christ and Him crucified. Then it said, after we preach Jesus Christ and Him crucified, we have to do what? Somebody say, stand, receive it. Well, okay, so somebody gets up here. So everything that I've done today, everything that's been happening up here, Holy Spirit's been, if you don't receive it in today, it's useless. Isn't that right? Unless the Holy Spirit convinces you to receive it, it's just been words thrown out into the air. That's what the Bible said. He's preaching the gospel, and then he said you had to, number two, is what? Receive it. Now notice what the Bible says here in Proverbs chapter 2, verses 1 through 5. Notice it says, my son, if thou will receive what? My words, and hide my commandments with thee, so that thou incline thine ear unto wisdom and apply thine heart to understanding. Yea, if, notice, thou criest after knowledge, liftest up thy voice for understanding, if, what? Thou seek her as silver and search, what? As hid treasure. Now notice this, here comes this word then. What does that mean? Does that mean if we've, by God's grace, done the first four verses? Yes, if we follow the counsel, the first four, then thou shalt understand, notice this, the fear of the Lord and find the knowledge of God. If anything was needed in the movement today, it's to understand the fear of the Lord, dear friend, and find out the knowledge of God. Yes. The fear of God, dear friend, is to understand the fear. You say, oh, all of these things, I don't understand it. What I want to do is underline those, and we'll go into them next week. Remember, he said, you have to receive the word. We'll give you a little hint. You notice that? Receiving the word. You know, what word? What word? Matthew 4, verse 4, it says what? Every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. That's where you start, isn't it? So we take these things and start putting them together, because God said, if I can get these things straight, then I'm going to have another step closer to receiving the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, the latter rain. To give me that power that I need to help me, not only for my own life to prepare and give me victory, because it's going to take a power outside of each one of us today to gain the victory over how the enemy has hit you. The things that so easily beset you or me sometime, it's going to take a power outside of ourselves. Remember,